On behalf of the Foundation for Agrarian Studies, I welcome you all to the second FAS annual oration. The Foundation is a charitable trust based in India and established in 2003. Its major objectives are to facilitate and sponsor multidisciplinary theoretical and empirical inquiry in the field of agrarian studies in India and elsewhere in less developed countries. As a network of academics and research scholars, it is supported by progressive corporate organizations and donor agencies that are interested in promoting research to eradicate hunger, poverty, and malnutrition, promote gender equality, and research on measures to reduce social and economic inequalities. The Foundation regularly conducts seminars, conferences, and workshops to disseminate the results of its research to the wider academic community, peasants and agricultural workers, organizations, women's associations, and student groups. In the year 2018, we added another name to the list of events that we regularly plan to organize, the FAS Annual Public Lecture. The first annual lecture was organized to mark the 15th anniversary of the establishment of the Foundation. It was delivered by Professor M.S. Swaminathan on the subject, Science Shaping the Future of Agricultural Production. In 2019, we tried to conduct the second annual lecture, but we were mostly occupied with a series of village surveys and could not succeed in organizing it. We therefore were highly motivated to have the second in the series in early 2020 and were fortunate enough to get the time from Professor Shenggen Fan. Professor Fan had kindly agreed to travel to India to deliver the public lecture on modernization of agriculture production in China. This was scheduled for March 2020, but the pandemic and its grave impact on life and work in general overtook that opportunity. We were still hopeful of being able to conduct this event sometime in late 2020, but eventually that opportunity was lost. In the light of the changed circumstances, we decided to shift to the online mode and were extremely fortunate at least on two accounts. One, to get the support from the Rosa Luxemburg Stiftung to jointly organize this and many such events. So this to jointly organize the second FAS annual lecture with them. And secondly, and most importantly, to get the time from Professor Fan, you know, his slot from his schedule. So here we are. And once again, let me welcome you all to the second annual lecture of the Foundation for Agrarian Studies. Professor Shenggen Fan continues in the distinguished tradition that was set up through our first annual lecture. He's a major international expert in agriculture and food policy. Until recently, very recently, he was the Director General of the International Food Policy Research Institute, IFPRI, where he served for 20 years in different capacities. Professor Fan currently is a chair professor at the College of Economics and Management at the China Agriculture University at Beijing. He is a member of the Global Panel on Agriculture and Food Systems for Nutrition. He serves at the boards of and advisory councils of numerous academic institutions and corporate bodies. He is a council of advisors of the World Food Prize and a member of the lead group of the Scaling Up Nutrition Movement appointed by the UN Secretary General. On behalf of the Foundation, I once again welcome Professor Shenggen Fan.
Oh, thank you. Yeah,
I also welcome our very distinguished chair for this lecture today, Professor V.K. Ramachandran. Professor Ramachandran is vice chairperson of the Kerala State Planning Board, although he is here today with us today as the honorary managing trustee of the Foundation for Agrarian Studies. Ramachandran has a deep research interest in development economics and with a particular focus on different aspects of agrarian relations in India. He also concerns himself with issues of laborers and workers and different forms of social oppression, particularly caste and gender in India. Let me invite the chair for today's lecture, Professor Ramachandran, to take us through the program. Professor Ramachandran, please.
Professor Shenggen Fan, Sandeepan, and my colleagues from the Foundation for Agrarian Studies, and all of those who are following us on Facebook, YouTube, and other social media sites. Welcome, good afternoon, good evening, good morning, depending on which part of the world you are in. It is my great pleasure to chair this lecture, the second annual oration of the Foundation for Agrarian Studies. The annual oration was something that we started in the 15th year of the Foundation for Agrarian Studies. The foundation is now, I think, well established as one of India's leading networks and think tanks in the sphere of agrarian studies. And we were very honored to have as our first annual orator, Dr. M.S. Swaminathan, the first winner of the World Food Prize. We are equally now today honored that we have continued that tradition of having very eminent international personalities in the field of food and agriculture as the person who gives us the annual oration. Welcome, Dr. Shenggen Fan. I have heard a great deal of you, about you. I have, of course, read your work, and it is a pleasure to have you here. I shall not take much time. I shall consider myself today to be mainly a timekeeper. We are very fascinated, too, by the title of your lecture, because as anyone involved with policy is aware, the complexities of economic policy have really been brought to the fore during the pandemic, and particularly in the agricultural and food sector, because of the complexity of supply chains and production in this sector. It has been of great importance for us, agricultural policy in this period. It is also of great relevance during this period because we find, and it is in different parts of the world, including our part of the world, the revival of livelihoods. Agriculture, the sphere of agriculture and rural development activity is a sphere in which we can get livelihoods back. We can put people back to work. So in these respects, the agriculture and food sphere have been very important over the period of over this current period of pandemic. But I'm sure that Professor Shenggen Fan's talk will take us much beyond that as well. We'll deal with the present crisis, but will take us beyond that as well. We have also benefited a great deal from your article, Professor, recently in the Review of Agrarian Studies. As you know, we have the foundation has a new pandemic studies unit, and one of the achievements of the unit was to publish a series of articles in which yours was the lead article in our journal, the Review of Agrarian Studies. Without further ado, may I request Professor Shenggen Fan to speak, shall we say, about 40, 45 minutes, Professor Shenggen Fan? Is that all right? And then we will open it out for discussion.
Well, thank you. Thank you, Dr. Ramachandra.
Thank you.
I'm so happy to see my friend, Madhura, and also thank Sandeep for organizing this event. I hope you can hear me well. Do you hear me well?
Yes, clearly.
Okay, Very good.
Yeah, I will request everyone else to switch off their mics.
Okay, very good. Yeah, so it's my profound honor to speak on this lecture series, particularly after my great hero, S.M. Swaminathan. So I have worked with him for so many years, so he has been my personal hero and also a mentor. So when I was IFPRI Director General, I interacted with him many times, including through the Harvest Plus biofortification program, including the Compact 2025 program. Now, the program had an aim to end hunger and malnutrition by the year of 2025. So I wanted to attribute my presentation to him, and I wish him good health and good spirit. Now, what I'm going to do
We will convey that to him. Thank you for your message.
Great, that would be great. I was actually planning to stop in Chennai to see him if I had a chance to visit you guys in India. So what I'm going to do in the next 40 to 45 minutes is to use the Chinese experience to show how can we really build agriculture and rural resilience to make sure that everybody, whether they are poor, whether they're hungry, whether in a different segment of the society, or whether they're farmers or peasants, can really benefit from our future development. Now, just a second, let's make it, okay, here we go. So firstly, I'm going to walk through how the COVID-19 has impacted Chinese agriculture and the food system. And then secondly, analyze how government policies have responded. And thirdly, lessons from China. So what lessons we can really draw, what mistakes we could have avoided from the Chinese experience. And finally, I wanted to emphasize the resilience and inclusion. So resilience and inclusion will be as important as other dimensions of our research, of our engagement to push the future food system, such as nutrition, health, employment, the sustainability, mitigating the climate change, and so on. So the impact of the COVID-19 on China was very severe, particularly from January to March. So this chart will show you, from January to March, the first quarter, the Chinese GDP went down almost 7%. And then agriculture was hit also very hard. Agriculture declined by more than 3%. Particularly some of the sectors that employ so many low-skilled laborers, for example, construction, hotels, restaurants, got hit very hard. So for example, hotels and restaurants went down by more than 35%. Construction and wholesale retail went down by 17-18%. So the impact was severe. So many people were struggling with their day-to-day life. But fortunately, by April to June, you will see the economy has more or less recovered. So total GDP growing at just 3.2%, agriculture 3.4%, manufacturing more than 4%, and construction also recovered to almost 8%. But the hotel and the restaurants continue to decline, continue to shrink. Even in the second quarter, the hotel and the restaurant went down by more than 18%. Then the third quarter, July, September, we have seen overall further recovery from the pandemic. Economy continued to grow, with its total GDP, agriculture, manufacturing, construction, utilities, and beyond. However, the hotel and the restaurants continue to shrink by more than 5%. So that is the figure. In October, we have seen that the hotel and restaurants begin to go up, to increase by probably 2%. So over the last 10 months, so we have seen the big hit in the first quarter, the gradual recovery during the second quarter. I think by the third quarter, the economy, the livelihoods, employment have more or less recovered, except for hotels and restaurants. Now, I just wanted to mention a couple of so-called hotspots that have mainly been impacted by the COVID-19. So the shock on livestock sector is particularly large, particularly poultry sector. Because lack of access to feed, lack of access to labor, lack of access to market. So in February, most of the poultry factories in China were severely affected. So production went down by more than 50%. The 80% of enterprises were affected. In many cases, the live chicken and ducklings have to be buried because of lack of access to markets. So as a result, the total production of the poultry has come down by quite a big margin. Now, so as a result, the food price index went up. So you will see around February 2020, so there is a spike of many food items, particularly that's the livestock products, fruits, vegetables, and so on. And So total, so the food price inflation went up by more than 5%. So, however, most of the food prices become very stable from March onward. And by April, by May, most of the food prices have become normal. So it was hit very hard in February. Again, it has recovered in March and April. So by April, by May, most of the food items have become pretty stable. Now, so as a result, urban and rural residents has greatly reduced the consumption expenditure, particularly food items, partly because of the lost jobs, lost income. I will come back to this later. So you will see that the both rural and household reduced the expenditures, you know, in urban area by more than 58%. Your total is about 50%. And particularly on food. So the households begin to pay more attention to accessibility so they can access food. However, in terms of other dimensions of food security, for example, the nutrition, whether it's a stability or affordability, have been compromised severely. So from the right chart, you will see that the yellow bar is accessibility is high priority for many residents. However, the gray bar is variety. So you will see that the consumers have reduced their variety. So focus on bulk foods like rice, wheat, and maize at the cost of fruits, vegetables, dairy production, and so on. And a negative impact on employment, particularly for rural migrants. So employment, a full-time position, fell in agriculture sector by more than one third in the first quarter. And the migrants, as you know, migrants, rural migrants account for a big share of the total rural labor, rural workers, and their employment went down more than 30%. And in addition to that, their wages also went down by more than 6%. Even though some may have job, but wages were cut down by more than 6%. And most of the migrant workers work in a sector that are very vulnerable to pandemic. So for example, construction, service, and manufacturing. Now here I wanted to mention that the restaurant services here in China employ another female workers and restaurants, hotels, the hospitality services were severely disrupted. So women were affected much higher, much more significantly than men. Now, many small and medium-sized enterprises were severely affected, as I already mentioned. So many poultry sector companies, many supply chain companies, transportation companies, anything related to food and agriculture was severely affected. The whole supply chain was severely disrupted in towards the end of January, the whole February, and the beginning of March. And for upstream enterprises, so in short run, the impact of the outbreak is relatively small, let's say but the biggest issue for them is a labor shortage, so upstream enterprises. Now, so downstream enterprises have suffered much more than anything else. Downstream means this enterprise much closer to food production. Now, so the impact varies depending on where you are in the whole value chain or supply chain. Now, how government has responded? So here I just mentioned that as a researcher, so I came back to China in January and COVID-19 began to show towards the end of January. So as a researcher, I formed an online discussion group among scholars, policy advisors, just to share the information to detect any potential food crisis locally, regionally, or even at a national or even global level. So we have done several online discussions on that. But based on the online discussions, we prepared various policy briefs for the government. We also prepared another op-ed in the newspaper. In addition, we also called the attention of the UN organization like FAO, the World Bank, IFPRI, to let them pay attention to a potential food crisis So we wanted to make sure that this health crisis will not lead to a food crisis. So we have done, so we are very proud of that. The governments have used some of our data, information, evidence in designing certain policy. The UN organizations, FAO, the World Bank, have also issued many sort of policy guidelines, many even use some of their loans, their, let's say the policy packages to make sure that the countries do pay attention to food and nutrition security concerns during pandemic. One of the key milestones is G20. So China, India, even US, some of the European countries, South Africa, Russia are part of the G20. So in May and June G20 ministers of agricultural meeting hosted by Saudi Arabia. So they issued a declaration or statement saying that no country should use export ban to secure their food domestically at the cost of the global food supply. I thought that statement really helped. It's a key milestone, how the countries can work together to prevent some of the global crises. So as a result, many countries like Vietnam, Russia, Ukraine, stopped using this food export ban and to make sure that global food continues to flow freely across the countries. So I thought that was a key milestone. Now, if from China, the government obviously has been watching, monitoring the situation very, very carefully, very seriously. So at the end of January, so the Minister of Agriculture and Rural Affairs, the Minister of Transportation, Ministry of Public Security jointly issued an emergency notice to ensure that normal flow of food basket products and agriculture input materials. So they recognize that another feeding industry, poultry industry, and agriculture food supply chains were affected by lockdowns, by roadblocks. So they issued that emergency notice. Then in early February, from the top government, so the Prime Minister of China, Mr. Li, called on ministries to coordinate to ensure an ample supply of food and effective logistics for delivering agriculture inputs, emphasizing the responsibility of local authorities. Then, you know, in February, obviously more government policies, regulations came out, particularly it's on February 10, the government introduced special incentives for farmers to start farming. As you know, the Chinese sort of planting season usually starts in March and April. If the farmers do not have access to seeds, access to inputs, then the whole year's production could be compromised. So the ministry issued a policy to make sure that the farmers have incentives to access to seeds, access to inputs, make sure that they plan their production well. Then again, when they see the livestock was very much sort of disrupted, so the Minister of Agriculture and other two ministries issued a measure to support the reopening of feed and meat processing enterprises as soon as possible to ensure that smooth delivery of raw materials and products. So you can see various policies. And on trade side, the government also encouraged food imports to ease the pressure on food supply. So they reduced some of the bottlenecks, logistic constraints to import foods from Brazil, even from US. As you know, before that, there was a trade war between US and China. China imposed some of the import tariffs on US products. So as a result, the Chinese administration reduced some of the trade tariffs, make sure that the imports can come freely or without any disruption. Now, finally, the administration pledged to speed up customs clearance, shorten quarantine and a review period, and open green channels for agriculture products in key ports. So the green channel idea was formally sort of recognized towards the end of February. So domestically, the food supply, food enterprises, the farmers' production, and then imports barriers have been lifted. So all these policies, we call them green channels. And I'm happy to recognized in many countries, including Africans and even some of the Latin American, begin to use the terminology as green channels to make sure that food and medical products can be transported, can be handled freely without much impact from lockdowns, from roadblocks. Now, of course, we have to take into consideration of the health of the workers, of the truck, of the truck drivers, of the people working in the port. So that has to be given. And well, from the supply side, many local governments also begin to issue this so-called consumer vouchers, make sure that consumers have access to foods, even though the income, the payment, the ability to pay is very limited because, you know, not income, not the job. So the government issued vouchers to make sure that the citizens can have access to medical service, to foods, and so on. And using e-commerce, you know, using e-commerce to really make sure that the supply side and the demand side can be linked, can be, let's say, also contracted. You know, the lots of producer communities sign a contract with the consumer communities. But every day, you know, they send the order and the production communities begin to organize their products and shift it and transport it to consumer markets or communities without any stop in the middle. So that really helped. I live in a community of the China Agricultural University. So every morning I can see the trucks, you know, with green channel, with government special policy, to come to our communities and then sell their products to residents here at the China Agricultural University. So some of the lessons from China, obviously, you know, we have seen the policies, we have seen the impact. So what can we do better in the future? First, so there is a need to monitor food prices and markets very closely. You know, we used to collect the data every quarter, every month. But the lesson we learned is that's not good enough. We need almost daily, if not hourly data on food prices, on food supply, on the market situation. As economists, we know if there is a problem with the food price, whether it's food price spikes goes up or goes down or high volatility, we know there is a problem in food market, either supply side or demand side. And we know that many poor people, hungry people will be affected. So the Chinese experience has shown that transparent dissemination of information will strengthen government management over the food market and prevent people from panicking and guide farmers to make rational production decisions. Yeah, there were some panic purchasing in the supermarkets. There were some panicking sort of hoarding of the producers. But if the government can issue timely price information in different markets so the foods can move around freely. And obviously government can also set up the stocks, whether it's regional stocks or even community food bank stocks can help the smooth market prevent its hoarding behavior or panic purchasing behavior. So here we wanted to emphasize that traditionally we very much focus on global and national prices. Again, the lesson we learn is we must also connect the data, timely data, more frequent data at a local, regional, and a community level. Now, the second lesson we learned is obviously to ensure the international and the national agriculture food supply chain functions so well, you know, under the crisis or under the pandemic. So opening green channel for fresh agriculture products. And we hope, we wish that the green channel could have opened a bit earlier, given that the workers' health have also been secured. So that's huge lessons we learned. And obviously ban the unauthorized roadblocks. So many communities, particularly rural communities, set up a lot of unauthorized roadblocks, blocking anybody coming, blocking anybody going out. I think some of the policy could be adjusted better to make sure that the migrants can go back to their work. The workers can also come back to the working facilities. Now the e-commerce is another sort of a lesson. So you, to some extent, actually it's a positive experience. The e-commerce was boosted during the during pandemic because of the social distancing, because of roadblocks. So the normal citizens will not be able to go out. So in this case, e-commerce, the fast delivery companies help the consumers to access to the fresh foods, health services from providers. So I think we could do better in the future. More infrastructure investment, more policy regulation to encourage e-commerce, e-platforms to link consumers and producers much better, much more efficiently. So here the special policies, you know, have been introduced to transport rural migrants from point to point without stops in transit so that economies can return to normal as soon as possible while also protecting rural migrants from infection. So yes, then in the beginning here in China, it was very much focused on products, food products, medical products. So one point to another point. But in March, in April, the focus has been shifted to workers. So from, let's say, one community, you know, particularly the source of migrants to the destination of their worker host. So that really helped to solve some of the it's a labor shortage in big cities, in Shanghai, in Beijing, in Shenzhen, or in Zhejiang provinces. And we wish that could happen a bit earlier, let's say right after Chinese New Year, maybe February, the beginning of March. And by the way, I do think the rural migrants were hit pretty hard this year. They might have lost a 1 month income or maybe 2 month income. So many of these rural migrants just live above the poverty line. It depends on how you measure the poverty line, whether it's a $1.90 per day or $3.50 per day. It's a $3.50 per day. So many rural migrants live just above that poverty line. So could you imagine if they lose, let's say 2 months of the income, that's, you know, 10 to 20% of the income. So many could have dropped into poverty. But the good thing is sometimes in June, the government launched a big effort to make sure that nobody is still in poverty. So the Chinese ambition is to end extreme poverty by the end of this year. Huge efforts, subsidies, income transfer, education, and the aid to help them to find jobs. Now, another lesson is social safety nets. So this is something actually China could learn from India quite a bit. So Chinese social safety nets were launched some years ago, but much later than India. So in the first phase or second phase of the reform, let's say in the late 70s, in the 80s, 90s, the Chinese were very much focused on growth, not much on, let's say, social safety nets. The inclusion part is more or less through growth, so the regional development, focusing on poor regions, or focus on sectors that poor, where the poor people work. So that's sort of targeting sectors, targeting regions. But social safety nets to target to individuals were not part of the government priorities. So that has been changed lately, particularly for the last 5 years. So various social safety nets have been set up. For example, social safety nets to help the aging population, to help the disabled population, to help rural, that's a rural, particularly minority groups. So that worked very well. However, the coverage and the depth of a social safety net are still not satisfactory. So we really hope that the safety net can be broadened, particularly in its coverage. So the coverage of the social safety nets here in China is still very, very much limited. So another challenge is there are not rural migrants. So their household registration are still in rural area, but they are working in urban area. So how can China develop a unified social protection system or social safety net, it's a problem. You know, so for example, the rural migrants working in the cities that do not have access to a social safety net in the city, they still have to go back to their rural towns to access to their safety net. So that needs to be solved. So whether they are in urban area, whether they are in rural areas, they can access to a unified social safety net programs. So the third lesson is zoonotic diseases. We know that human and animals share probably 80% of infectious diseases. The common cold, flu, avian influenza or chicken flu, all these are shared between humans and animals. And as our supply chain has become more complex, longer, the interaction between human beings and animals have been intensified for the last decade or two. So we have seen increased zoonotic diseases for the last decades or two. And as you know, China experienced SARS. Again, SARS came from animal, so then jumped to humans. And COVID-19, although we're still investigating the origin of COVID-19, but it is clear that COVID-19 again came from animals. So how can we make sure that we introduce sort of no regulation to keep the certain distance between nature and human beings, between animals and human beings? And a special attention must be paid to the wet market, the sort of agricultural markets. Many farmers depend on this market to sell their products. Low-income rural residents also depend on the wet markets to access to affordable fresh vegetables and fruits and meat. So they are very important, but let's make sure that we have good regulation, good laws, good policy. And equally important, they have to be implemented, evaluated, monitored, and adjusted. So huge lesson, not just for China, I think for India, for Southeast Asia, and even for Africa. Now, another lesson is the resilience. I think one huge lesson we learned through the pandemic is the resilience. We have very much focused on efficiency. At a global level, global trade, we have very efficient global supply chain. It's soybean, palm oil, and the meat. So here in China imports so much soybean, 90 million tons from the international market, from Brazil and the US. When the soybeans are imported, they are processed here in China for soy meals, as animal feeds, and for cooking oils. And some of the products were also exported to other countries and listed until 2 or 3 years ago. So you can see this whole value chain, globalized, efficient, but they're also vulnerable. So how can we make sure that we can build a global resilient food trade system? And equally important is a local market, local food system. They must also be resilient. So there is a debate, or there is a new thinking, whether we can shorten the supply chain. Let's say we promote local production, local communities. So local production has some advantages. For example, you avoid non-transportation, reduce potential carbon emission from transportation. Also reduce exposure to some of the food safety issues. And again, reduce the shocks, let's say, to climate, to trade wars, to diseases. However, by doing that, we may also lose some efficiency. So not every place, not every region, every community can produce something that the community needs. So you still need international market, global market, national market, to make sure that the consumers or residents, they have access to diverse, nutritious, and healthy food. So it's a balance between the long supply chain and a shortened local food production. And this is a research topic we needed to do in the future. And then in longer run, we know that investment in agriculture research, in rural infrastructure, in farmers' education, will be able to build the capacity of local community and local residents to deal with the shocks, to recover from the shocks, and grow even better after shocks, so-called resilience, so the capacity to increase their resilience. And here I wanted to mention the technologies. Yeah, in addition to being a member of the advisory group for World Food Prize, I'm also a board member of One CGIR. So I think the new technology coming from CGIR or from national system must have multiple wins. But during Green Revolution, you know, for example, and the SM Swaminathan, Dr. Swaminathan, really pushed for high yielding varieties, whether it's wheat, whether it's rice. I mean, at that time, it was very timely, very critical, very important to do that. However, in the future, I think we must make sure that newer technology, newer varieties should also have the ability to stand against the shocks, whether it's climate shocks, like droughts, floods, or disease shocks against certain diseases, whether it's plant diseases like a wheat rust or pests and beyond. And equally important, nutrition. Now, can new technologies or newer varieties bring more nutrition in addition to high yielding, in addition to the resilience against the shocks? And I'm happy to see that Dr. Swaminathan also begin to work on nutrition, begin to work on resilience. So I think as the world has changed, we begin to adapt our new technologies to new challenges. Now, so what do we want for our food system? So before the COVID-19, the food system we wanted to have must be productive and efficient because our land is limited, our labor is moving out. So we need a more productive and efficient food system. And low carbon, we know that food and agriculture food system emits 30% of greenhouse gas. So even other sectors, energy, transportation, can do a good job, zero carbon or carbon neutral. But agriculture does not do anything, business as usual. Even agriculture food sector alone will push our planet maybe 1.5 or 2 degree warmer. So agricultural food sector have been part of the challenges. But if we do it right, it could also be part of the solution to make sure that we deal with the climate change by sequestrating carbon into the soil. And a healthy and a nutritious. So our food system must produce healthy and a nutritious foods. That is because, you know, we're facing triple burden of malnutrition. Yeah, we still have 690 hungry people. We still have more than 2 billion people who suffer from lack of micronutrients, heat and hunger, the 2 billion. And another 2 billion suffer from overnutrition, overweight and obesity. So you will see altogether, probably 30 or even close to 40% of the total population in the world suffers from one form or another form of malnutrition. So our food system must address that issue. That's sustainable. You know, we use too much water, too much land. We lose biodiversity in producing our food. So in the future, we must make sure that we protect our land, we use our water more efficiently, we protect our biodiversity. But COVID-19 is a wake-up call. And it's the two elements must be more prominent in our future food system. One is the resilience, as I have already mentioned. Another one is inclusion. IFPRI's 2020 Global Policy Research Report clearly highlights that it is poor people, it is hungry people, it is women, it is children, it is disadvantaged smallholders who are much more affected by the COVID-19 and that do not have the capacity, let's say, to recover. They do not have the capacity to grow even better after the COVID-19. So I want to highlight resilience and inclusion as equally important as other dimensions of the future food system we would like to have. So what do we do? How can we make sure that we have resilient food system. One is to transform smallholder for resilience. I'm so happy that the foundation focuses on agrarian studies. So it is smallholders who lack access to secure land, to inputs, to social services. So the smallholders must be our top priorities to make sure that they can help to build the resilient food production. So strengthen land tenure security. You know, it's still the case that many smallholders do not have access to secure the land. So when they do not have secure land, then the land is fragmented. They do not have access to finance. They do not have access to inputs, and they will not be able to use ICT. So here in China, the government just released new regulation. So the smallholders' access to land users' rights have been extended for 30 years. So farmers with Chinese here in China, the farmers do not own the land. It's their collectives that own the land. But the farmers, individual farmers, have users' rights. So they can lease, they can rent, they can also market their land use rights to others. With proper regulation, proper legal framework, the users' rights can guarantee smallholders access to inputs, to finance, and to ICT. And then promote inclusive agribusiness patterns. So smallholders today still do not have equal share in the whole value chain. I will show you a figure later. So how can smallholders improve that's their income opportunities by improving the quality of their products to share more from the modern value chain? And obviously, they face tremendous risks. We need a social protection targeted to smallholders, insurance, and obviously they must pursue income diversification, so non-farm employment. I think India, if the government wants to double smallholders' income, you know, in the next 2 or 3 years, I think simply from agriculture is not enough. The diversification from agriculture, or agriculture is still very important, but non-agriculture will be so critical. Then carbon credit, you know, if farmers can sequestrate carbon into the soil, then they should be compensated. And I also argue that right now the $20 per ton of carbon is too low. So the farmers don't have much incentive to do that. If the carbon price increases to $50, $60 per ton, the farmers can sequestrate 1 ton, maybe 2 tons, maybe 3 tons per hectare per year. Then that sort of compensation is significant enough to make sure that farmers do have incentives to sequestrate the carbon into the soil and pursue conservation agriculture. Now, engaging the private sector for resilience, private sector in agriculture. Here, I wanted to emphasize the SMEs, small and medium-sized enterprises related to food and agriculture. So firstly, the resilience concept must be mainstreamed into their business strategy. You know, the SMEs, their strategy usually focus on profit, income, revenue, but not on resilience. Resilience must be mainstream against the shocks. We know that, you know, they will face shocks probably every other 2 or 3 years. Mainstream resilience to their management, HR, you know, finance, and so on. So they must have the capacity to mainstream resilience to their management. And a government policy should also help these SMEs to strengthen their resilience. For example, some physical support, some capacity training support, and make sure that smallholders or small and medium enterprises can still stand even after certain shocks, whether future climate shocks, droughts, market shocks, financial shocks, and the health shocks. that building resilient food supply chains. So as I said, in the past, we have very much focused on efficiency, very efficient food supply chain, very efficient food system. Yeah, for example, high yielding varieties, productive sector, specialization, global value chain or national value chain. But if you wanted to pursue resilience, we need a backup of redundancy. You know, when you fly, you take another Boeing or Airbus. All these airplanes have backups. So if one system fails, another system will kick in. If the second system fails, the third one will kick in. So sometimes they have three or four backups, but our food system do not have that backup. So what do? We needed to diversify our value chain, not just one or two, let's say imports, instead of focusing on one or two large exporters. We could actually diversify our imports to more countries and deliberately develop importing markets. That's Africa, South Asia, not just Brazil, not just the US. So backup and diversity. And I was sort of, here I also wanted to mention that the stocks, reserves. We need more reserves. We need more stocks at different levels, community level, regional level, national level, and even global shared stocks, regional shared stocks. It's Southeast Asia, West Africa, East Africa. And the food banks is also a good idea. Here in China, we only have one food bank in Shanghai called Green Food Bank. US, Africa have so many food banks. And India also has a mass food bank. Even community India has food banks. And that concept deserves more attention. But use food banks to help the poor to access to food and help as a food companies and individuals to deliver to donate the surplus foods to the food banks. I think here China can learn quite a bit from many other countries to build a resilience in the community, in the individual families, and in different regions. Now, support efficient and inclusive value chain. This is my last slide. If you look at the right chart, you will see that. Okay, in Starbucks, a typical cup of coffee costs you $2.50. Do you know how much a smallholder will get? Only 1 cent. 1 cent out of 250 cents. So this is not fair to our farmers. This is not fair to our smallholders. So can we increase the share of smallholders in the value chain? You know, 5%, 10%, or maybe even 1/4. There are some efforts, for example, at a global level, so-called fair trade mechanisms or cooperative trade mechanisms. We need to do more. It's not just a lip service. We wanted to make sure that smallholders are included in the whole value chain and to make sure that smallholders deserve a decent share so they can educate their children, they can make sure that their family has access to nutritious and healthy foods. So I want to stop over here. I usually, my sort of preference is to listen to the audience. And going back to you, Dr.
Thank you. Thank you very much.
We'll stop the share.
Thank you for that very, very interesting and very clear and interesting lecture. Thank you very much. I'm going to go, we have half an hour now. I'm going to invite all those listening to post questions either on, to post questions either on your through Facebook and YouTube or direct, those of you who are on registered to put it onto our chat box here. We already have three. I already have three questions, Professor. One, let me Perhaps I'll go one by one. The first is by Dr. Aparajita Bakshi, who is from the Foundation for Agrarian Studies, and she joins us from Hong Kong today. She says that she is trying to understand how the structures and policy implementation mechanisms in China are different and how they have helped to lead to such swift economic recovery. In that context, she has three questions. One, were there any measures to regulate prices? Number two, were there any measures directly to stimulate demand? And number three, what would roughly be the magnitude of the Chinese stimulus package? So she's trying to see what did China do different in the context of these three questions. I leave it to you here.
Thank you. These are excellent questions. Excellent questions. In terms of prices, there are no formal regulations. However, the governments are watching whether there are speculations, hoarding behavior. So if there are sort of speculations or hoarding behavior, they will be punished. But this not only applies during crisis, even in normal time. The speculations are not allowed. Now with some private sector, particularly food and agriculture companies, they said, we are promised, we committed not to increase food prices. So that's a good sign. So the private sector companies, particularly food and agriculture areas, the association, their industry, everybody said, we are not going to increase our food prices. So that's how the prices have been quite stable, particularly after February. Now, in terms of demand side, yes, another social protection. The firstly, from the government side, government employees have most of their income. They are paid on time. They have been very stable. As you know, the public sector is quite a big, if you include state-owned enterprises. So that has been a cornerstone of the demand side. Then obviously social protection, income transfer to many disabled, disadvantaged, low-income population. Although it comes a bit later than we wish, for example, income transfer came maybe March, April, and so on. We wish that could have done a bit earlier. Now, in terms of urban residents, so many cities, China actually is a decentralized system. So many provinces, many cities have their own revenues. So they actually issue their coupons, vouchers to consumers. In many cases, actually universal, which is, to some extent, they want to stimulate the economy. On the other hand, I wish they could actually target the distribution of vouchers to poor neighborhoods or poor population groups. So that's on the demand side. Now, on the stimulus package, surprisingly, this time, the stimulus package is quite small in China. In the US, they use a quarter, 30% of their GDP equivalent, to stimulate the economy during crisis. For China, it's very small, maybe 3%, 4%, 5%. I think part of it, they are worried about, the economy may become too hot, or maybe inflation, or many other concerns. So the stimulus is not as big as many other countries. So they're very much focused on, giving enterprises financial support or debt, the loans. So not really, free credits and so on. So they wanted to have a longer term recovery and also make sure that the economy will not be overheating. And now it seems to me the economy has by and large recovered, particularly in construction, manufacturing, but the service sector is still not as good as we wish. As a comment said that it is women, it is low-skilled people who are most likely employed by the service sector. And unfortunately, the service sector has recovered the slowest than among all the sectors. So in fact, it is the manufacturing sector, construction sector that have recovered most strongly after the COVID-19. So I will stop over here. Let's go to another.
Fun. I think part of Dr. Bakshi's question was also, does China administer prices in situations like this? Do you offer a fixed price for, fix the prices of agricultural inputs, prices of product prices? Do you administer those prices in situations that, on a regular basis and in situations like this? And with relation to number two, measures to stimulate demand, do you also have, the free distribution of food through a public distribution system to large sections of the people in a period like this? That I think that was also implied in her question.
In terms of prices, there's no fixed prices from the government. There's no fixed, particularly in the consumer's market. As I said, it's more through policy regulation against speculation. Because supply are enough, demand is there, market is big enough, so let the market determine. Because the food price, it goes up. In many cases, it's because of speculation, not because of roadblocks. So if you solve the roadblocks problem, if you make sure that the market works, so I think the biggest effort for the government is to make sure that market works instead of fixing prices. So that's a key lesson. Then the private sector, because with speculation, for example, if I'm a private company, I see opportunity to make more money by increasing prices. The government is watching, and the private sector association is watching, said, hey, guys, let's work together. Let's spike our prices. So that have worked. But on the production side, China does have the so-called target prices. The target prices are much higher than India, you call it minimum price, right? So the target price, so farmers could sell their prices to the government if the market prices are lower than that price. So that production side has that. Now, in terms of free distribution of food to poor consumers, actually not in China. China usually uses income transfer. So to a lower population. So if the market works, if you have the money, if the market works, I don't need to, to have free food. I use the money to buy. I can choose whatever I want. Obviously, some people may choose junk food. So then the consumer's knowledge information about the nutrition is very critical. So the simple answer is China does not distribute food to poor people freely or free food. That's more income.
Yeah. I think Aparajita had a very short one sentence follow-up question. What is the total employment? What sector of the population is in public employment?
I don't have the figure. It should be depending on how you define it. If you include SMEs, state-owned enterprises, and the government, I think it could be easily 20%.
20%, thank you.
Yeah. Well, obviously, now, this guy earns more money than others, and they also provide, or they trickle down to a service sector, to other sectors.
The second question for us is from Professor Madhura Swaminathan from the Indian Statistical Institute in Bangalore, and she's asking from Bangalore. Women workers seem to have been affected severely by the decline in the hotel and restaurant sectors, as you mentioned. Has the government initiated any specific programs for women workers?
Yeah, no, the simple answer is no. So they basically provide some support to low-income population and to the sector that have been affected, particularly it's hotels, restaurants, some packages. But here the Chinese assumption is they think, and if they think men and women have equal access to income, to assets, to political power. Well, that's assumption, right? But reality is reality. I think in reality, the women in many cases do have issues in terms of their status. So here's something China could do more to make sure that women have more access to jobs, to income, to social services, to political power. I think in general, the Chinese do not think it's a problem. To be frank, they don't think it's a problem. They think a man and a woman are more or less equal. It is true that, for example, among all the top rich women in the world, many of them are Chinese. Many of them are self-made billionaires, women billionaires. So to some extent, there are some truth. But on the other hand, there are some issues, particularly in the rural community. So they are still discriminated. For example, divorcees, you know, divorced women, they may not have access to land. When they're divorced, where do they get the man? When these women are married out, right, from this community to another, where do they get the man? So there are still some issues that needs to be addressed.
And it's this is from the country which gave the world the slogan, "Women hold up, women hold up half the sky."
Huh? But so, to some extent, there is some truth, I must say. And in the heart, actually, women is more powerful in terms of income.
Now we have a question from Dr. R. Ramkumar. Ramkumar is a professor of economics at the Tata Institute of Social Sciences. In Mumbai, yeah. And he's also involved in policy in the Kerala State Planning Board. So Ramkumar writes, it is very interesting to note the measures taken in China to ensure the smooth operation of supply chains and economic relief to the people. My question is about how China sees a post-COVID world in agriculture. How different will the agricultural sector and policy look like in China after the pandemic? I ask this question also with particular reference to the use and the potential use of science and technology. And I assume Ramkumar also means science and technological research in the practice of agriculture.
Right. Okay. Well, thank you, Dr. Kumar. I think after COVID-19, there are a couple of things that might be very different. The one is the role of ICT will be much more prominent after COVID-19 because of some of the policy like social distancing, the increased the pandemic cases. So the people begin to think of how can we keep a proper distance between human and animals, and even between humans. So ICT is one. So in the agriculture sector, we have seen a booming ICT technologies, AI technologies, drones, the use of drones, more mechanized, more modernized farming tools. This will provide great opportunities for youth because the older generation like me will not be able to handle drones, AI, or these machines. And we have seen a rapid increase of these technologies applying in the food and agriculture sector. That's number one change. The second is, you mentioned about technologies. I think future technologies, in addition to ICT, automation, mechanization, the biotechnology will also be different. I think we will focus more on resilience, tolerance against the drought, tolerance against diseases, tolerance against probably climate change. We have seen that, particularly here in the universities. for example, here in CAU, China Agricultural University, they already began to launch large research program to look for technology, look for innovations that can work next time if another crisis comes. So pretty serious on that. Big money has been allocated to that. Again, that provides great opportunity for youth, young students, young scholars, young researchers to do more research, to introduce innovations against certain shocks. So that's another change. Now, I think smallholders, it's a wake-up call for smallholders. We will see a more consolidated land size, particularly in our new policy, extend the land use rights for 30 years. The children can also inherit the land use rights. So as more people move outside of agriculture sector, as farmers begin to age, they're going to retire. Now the government actually has introduced retirement policy for farmers. Could you imagine farmers can retire, can have a pension? It's the first time, right? After so many thousands of years in China, first time farmers would have pension. After 60, I don't know how, depending on region, the farmers will be able to receive some sort of pension from the government. How much is it depends on regional government. These are paid by provincial governments. So in some province could be $200 a month. In others, maybe only 50, really depend on their capability. So as all these elderly farmers exit from agriculture, as lots of young people move out of agriculture, that leaves opportunity for some young, bright farmers left behind to consolidate the land, to increase the size of operation, maybe from current, it's a 5 mu to 200 mu. So 200 mu, I think it's about, let me see how many acres, maybe 60 acres as one of the optimal size. So with 60 acres, so you will be able to make a decent life by producing foods and agriculture. So that's another big change we might see in the next 5 to 10 years. So there's probably three things I want. Well, SME, I should say SME will also be very, very different. Many SMEs have already bankrupt. So again, we'll see consolidation. So more efficient, more resilient, and it's more educated CEOs of heads of a company. Most likely they have survived. So it's educated. It's a one who have good management skills. And they will continue, will survive.
Yeah.
Will become even stronger in the future.
This is, very interesting. Thank you. That's really very interesting. Now, we have quite a few questions. One is from Mr. Gopi Shankar Gopi Guttan. Not sure where exactly he's asking from, but you spoke about the roles and responsibilities of regional and local administrations. Could you please elaborate, one, what were the strategies to identify regions, locations, and people who are in need of food? Two, what institutional mechanisms were set up for efficient distribution? And three, to what extent could China leverage the existing institutional arrangements? There are still quite a few questions left, so I'll request you to sort of keep that in mind.
Okay. Yeah, I will select some of the ones that I can address.
Shall I give you more questions now?
Let me deal with this too very quickly.
Yeah. Okay.
So in terms of governing system, China has a very centralized sort of administration system. So the central government delegates certain authorities, certain accountability to provincial governance. So it's called provincial governance responsibility system. So a governor of province is responsible for eradicating COVID-19, is responsible for providing food to everybody is responsible to ending hunger and poverty. If that governance failed to do that, central government can remove that person. And similarly, the provincial governor can delegate that authority accountability to prefect level, then again down to the community level. So that sort of centralized administration system usually works very well during crisis. So that's how they have worked. Now, for the regions of the people who are in need, food in need, very special programs designed to help them, particularly income transfer, not from food actually, which surprisingly, it's economics. You know, when the market works, when there's a food on market, the best way to help the poor is to give them money. So they can choose, they can optimize into their consumption, depending on their needs. Another, okay, how can government leverage current administrations? Yes, I think they have already done that. Basically, we use their strong administration system to move everything from the central government to province, to prefecture, to county, to community, so one by one. And in fact, during the COVID-19 crisis, many government officials have been sacked because of the lack of performance, lack of performance.
I'm going to go on. We have Ms. Durgesh Nandini, who has asked that for implementing policies of crop diversification in India, understanding farmers' attitudes is a very, very important issue and challenge. What kind of policy tools are used in China in this regard? What kind of policy tools? That's one. I'm going to ask you, I'm going to put two. They're not actually related. Okay, why don't you answer that? Answer that. You go
to the- right. I think even before COVID-19, we have been working on diversification in food and agriculture in many countries, including India, Africa, and China. I think a part of the reason why farmers have become so specialized is Punjab or Haryana. The specialized in wheat and rice is actually
government. Could you speak a little more into the mic? Could you say that again? Into the mic,
Yeah, I think that it's a policy failure. Policy. Because government provides subsidies for producing more wheat, more rice. Water subsidy, fertilizer subsidy, output price subsidy. So that's why the farmers have incentives to produce rice, wheat, and maize. So they are very important. Absolutely, they are very important. But in terms of nutrition, in terms of environment, farmers could diversify their food production. You know, when the rice and the wheat are adequate enough, they could produce fruits, vegetable, dairy production. Now, another diversification strategy actually goes beyond agriculture. That's non-farm activities. So rural infrastructure, education, and the internet access, these are very critical for rural non-enterprises to be developed. So I have not seen any places where farmers really getting very rich by doing agriculture, by using a small plot of land. So they must be the main.
Thank you. We have a very important question now from Professor Jayaraman, who comes to us from Chennai. He works at the M.S. Swaminathan Research Foundation and with an interest in specialization in climate change and science policy. Professor, you suggest that there are two phases in agricultural development. One that focuses on productivity and growth, and a later one on resilience and inclusion. But quantitatively, is there any strong evidence that the earlier phase, that is productivity and growth, lacked resilience, particularly in relation to the first Green Revolution period? Was it not better and more stable than the pre-Green Revolution agriculture? Then a related question, how precisely do you define resilience? because since resilience implies the ability to recover, what should be the metric of recovery? Incomes or production or what? Okay.
I think that's a very good question. I do think some of the technology development in the 70s, 80s made our food system very vulnerable. Because,
but more vulnerable than food.
That's right. So that's resilient. That's resilient for many reasons. One is they have become more specialized, like in my home country here in China. You know, they just focus on a couple of crops.
Which is that? As a matter of interest.
Rice and wheat.
As a matter of interest, which is that county?
Oh, in Jiangsu province, and the county, obviously,
Jiangsu,
Jiangsu province, very close to Shanghai. So, as you know, for rice is very vulnerable to diseases, very vulnerable to weather shocks, particularly the lower temperature, let's say during flower season. If you experience a lower temperature, then the rice yield will be compromised, similar to wheat. So that's a, so yes, we very much focus on yield, not necessarily just growth, yield. More yield, more production at the cost of resilience. But I also have to mention that nutrition. I think the 70s, 80s, here, at least again in my province, the people suffered from heat and hunger. They used to eat more diverse fruits, vegetables, barley. We used to produce barley in winter. Now it's all modern crops, modern foods, and genetically they also have become very sort of simple. So very vulnerable, not very resilient. Now, but recently, the government began to change that, partly because, okay, we have enough rice and wheat. People begin to reduce the consumption of rice and wheat. Income has risen. They wanted to consume more fruits, vegetables, the seafoods, meat, dairy products. So then, the government policy needs to shift. It's from investing in rice and wheat to investing in fruits, vegetables, horticulture, dairy production, seafoods. So policy needs to be accompanied with that change, diet shift, demand change. So, and resilience, absolutely. I think even up to now, we have not paid attention to resilience. Even we said so much about climate resilience. I know India has climate resilient villages and so on. We wanted to do more. We wanted to scale them up. So then smallholders can truly become resilient against shocks, weather shocks, disease shocks, economic shocks, or any other shocks. So I think it is a wake-up call. And how do we define resilience?
Yeah.
Ironically, IFPRI held a conference in Addis Ababa in 2014. The theme of that conference is on resilience. Unfortunately, people didn't pay attention to that. We had almost 1,000 people coming from different parts of the world to discuss resilience, the definition, the measurement, how can we really use resilience as a concept of development. Combining short-term relief to long-term development. So even back in 2014, now in terms of definition, and it's at that time we defined resilience as ability, capability, or capacity of the national level, national governments, local governments, communities, and individuals to deal with shocks, to recover from shocks, and even grow better after shocks.
I think Dr. Jairaman is asking, is the metric of recovery incomes or production or what is the...
Yes. So there are set of indicators. Income, production, more importantly, is people's access to nutritious and healthy foods. Because once their nutrition and health have been compromised, it will have long-term impact. Income, you know, may fluctuate, particularly for rich people. You know, if they lose 50% of income, I think as long as their health is still there, they can always be in the future. So I think that one key lesson we learned among all indicators, measurement, it is people's access to food, nutritious food, is the most important indicator in measuring resilience.
I'm sure the proceedings have been published, I guess. No? The proceedings have been published. Thank you.
That's right.
Now, with your permission.
Rajo Pandya Nath, you know, my chief of staff.
May I ask you permission to extend the meeting by 15 minutes, because there are a lot of interesting questions.
Sure.
With your permission.
Well, if you have time.
We do. Yeah. Now, Dr. Ramkumar has come back with another question, saying, Dr. Fan, Kerala is a state in India which has instituted pensions for farmers over the age of 60. For some years, we've had a pension for farmers over 60. But the other side of the spectrum is also important. Is there a specific policy to attract youth into agriculture in China? Huh? And what are your thoughts on this?
I do think it's quite important. I think we cannot just force them to come back to agriculture. Attraction is a good word. I have, one is obviously the access to land. So if the land policy has become more relaxed, more flexible, let's say young people goes back to usually their hometown, and then that person will be able to consolidate or rent the land from elderly farmers. And then this youth do this as a business. And again, I use my village as an example. So a young person come back to my village and he rented half of the land of the whole village from, 20 farmers. So he consolidated that land into one piece and produce lotus roots. You know, lotus roots, it's lotus for flowers, right? But here in China, we actually consume lotus roots as vegetables.
We do too. We eat it too.
Yes. Very nutritious, very healthy. So by doing that, he make money. 5 times, 10 times more than rice and wheat. So he makes money, it's a big size. That's one. Second, he also employs these rural elderly people. So these elderly people rent the land to this guy. But this guy also hires farmers back to work for him. Very light work, actually, you know, to help to ship the lotus roots, help to do this, to do that. So you can see they have a mutual interest. So this young farmer is doing business. But in the meantime, farmers receive two sources of income. One is rent rental. 1 acre, let me see, 1 acre of rent could be $100, 1 acre. It's pretty good income, right? And this farmers also work for him part-time. Every day, just on a daily basis, the wages could be $20. So it's a win-win. Win for this young person, win for all these farmers who give up the land to this young farmer. But what government has done? Government gave a loan to this young farmer because, he got all this land together. He has some assets somewhere in Shanghai or some other city, I don't know. So he got this loan from the government so he can increase his operation. He can purchase machines, inputs. So that's I think the key things government has done. One is of the land policy. and our farmers to rent out the land users' rights. That's one. Second is a loan from the government. Okay, so I can give you.
Say that again?
I think probably $100,000 loan, worth of $100,000 for that young farmer to consolidate the size to produce lotus roots.
Thank you.
So obviously, you know, this in a more proper region. Now, regarding the pension, I think Karana is a very good example. I really hope India could follow. You know, anybody who is over 50, particularly farmers, they deserve the pension. They are the same. I mean, here in China, they say, oh, everybody is equal, whether you're farmers, whether you're workers, whether you're the government office, we are all equal, we are all work for the society. But if you really think they are equal, they deserve the pension. So I think we should do more. Treat farmers, treat farming as a profession. When they retire from that profession, they deserve some pension.
We have the next question. These two short questions. One is from Dr. A. Suresh. I think if I've got the person right, then it is an agricultural economist and researcher in the state sector from Kochi. I would like to ask what is the broad impact of the pandemic on the Chinese export of agricultural products? How did China manage the disruptions in the supply chains of agricultural exports, not only imports? So that's his question.
Yeah. Okay. Well, thank you, Dr. Suresh. In January, towards the end of January, February, many countries began to ban the Chinese foods, partly because of fear. I think Malaysia, Indonesia, China exports lots of foods to Southeast Asian countries and to some extent to Europe, fruits, vegetables, and so on. So some countries begin to impose some of the bans because of hygiene or safety issues. Then the Chinese government negotiated with them, because China also imports a lot, right? So said, hey, don't ban all this. But we don't know the sources of pandemic. And it's just, as far as we know right now, it's from wet markets, from animals. There's no strong case to show that, you know, the foods can be contaminated by pandemic. So I think through hard work negotiation, after 1 month, many countries lifted that ban. Now, it's interesting enough, the Chinese imports of foods become an issue. For example, many, many cases, newer cases here in China, in Tianjin, in Inner Mongolia, all came from imported foods. Well, it's not food, it's in the package. So I think it's mainly from human contacts. So for example, somewhere, let's say in Ecuador, I don't know, there's another country, maybe in US, when these workers pack their foods, and these workers are already being affected. So they touch the boxes, and this virus were on the boxes, and they could survive for a long time, particularly when the climate is wet and cold. So in China, at least 3 or 4 cases came from that. So this is, I think the world needs to watch for this. So on the one hand, we want to make sure that international trade continue to flow. On the other hand, make sure that these foods or these imports, export products will not become a tool or means of transmission. So the check, the quarantine must be ensured. Otherwise, the transmission will shift from human to human, to product to human. So that's a serious warning right now.
We have a question from Mr. V. Namaswam, who's a leading management consultant. He's asking from Bangalore, I believe. What is the relative fund allocation for agricultural research in the 5-year plans?
We are very much working on that right now. China is entering the 14th five-year plan. For the last five-year plan, 13, I think it's about 0.7% of agriculture GDP equivalent to agriculture research. For rich countries like US, Canada, Germany, it is 3-4%. So Chinese percentage is still very low compared to rich countries. So 0.7, 0.8% of agriculture GDP. India, it's only 0.3%, half of that China. So I think China needs to double, India needs to triple or quadruple its agriculture research. But this is a source of innovation. This is a source of new technologies. This is a source of future productivity. So I just cannot emphasize enough, or I just cannot say enough about increasing agriculture research investment in countries like China and India. Brazil is doing better than India and China. So they spend 1.5% or maybe even 2% of their agriculture GDP equivalent on agriculture research. So can we do better? I think we can. For the next 5 years plan, absolutely. So we are arguing for at least 1%. And also focusing on multiple wind technology, as I already mentioned. So research will continue to promote yield productivity, but equally important, the nutrition. Equally important is to save natural resources, conservation, and climate resilience, mitigate climate mitigation. So that is, and is what we have proposed. The final document will be released maybe sometime soon, next year, next March, when China has its national congress, next March. But we have already seen some draft, we have already seen some summary. So that's where we are right now.
We have a question from Dr. R.V. Bhavani. She is at the M.S. Swaminathan Research Foundation. She says that India has a large population dependent on agriculture. Are there lessons from the township and village enterprise approach of China, one? And number two, does land use planning, she asks, is there land use planning in China? That, of course, there is. But does land use planning in China decide how much of what should be grown and where it should be grown?
Okay, on first question, rural enterprises, absolutely. China started its agriculture reform in 1978 to give farmers use the rights. But that time, the rural non-enterprises were prohibited. The focus was on food production. The focus on self-sufficiency, grains. But the reform released productivity. Productivity went up. People had enough to eat. They even have surplus capital. Then starting from 1985, the government relaxed its policy and allowed farmers to engage with non-farm activities, whether it's service sector, whether it's a processing, whether it's small industry. So from 1985, probably somewhere to 2000, that was a booming period for rural enterprises in China. And at one time, the rural enterprises accounted for almost half of the total industry in China, almost a quarter of the total GDP in China. So could you imagine, you know, how big it is? These are rural enterprises, not urban. So farmers still sleep in their home, but they go somewhere to work in the local factories. So they're called living agriculture, but not leaving their home. We call it that strategy. So that worked very well. The things changed maybe after 2000 because the rural enterprises have become so big, so large. The government don't follow the rural enterprises. Just a second, excuse me, I think somebody's calling me. Let me stop this. The privatization. So they treat rural enterprises as city enterprises. So there's no special treatment, nothing. And particularly after China joined WTO in 2001. So you can see the rural enterprise played a critical role from 1985 to 2000 in generating employment, in generating income, and also to really push the reform pressure on the urban industry. Because you know, if the urban industry does not reform, they will not be able to compete with rural enterprises anymore. So I just cannot emphasize enough about the importance of the rural enterprises during that period of time. But obviously today we don't have that distinction anymore. It's all private sector, whether it's rural, whether it's urban, because the rural enterprises go to the cities. Urban enterprises also go to the areas. So it's not the rural areas. Now you don't see the difference anymore. They're all treated equally. It's the same. Yeah, going back to you.
Vikyar, you are muted.
Do you want to say a word on land use planning?
Oh yeah, land use planning. Can you hear me now?
Yeah.
With the host that I muted, okay. Yeah, land use planning, absolutely. As you said, China has land planning strategy policy, particularly in securing agriculture land. So I think it's about 1.8 billion mu is so-called red line for agriculture. It's not allowed to have all our agriculture land below that. So it's a red line, just cannot cross. And so obviously, if some cities wanted to develop industry zones, industrial parks, then they need approval from the government, central government. They also need to make sure that some land somewhere else will be compensated. So for example, if Shanghai wanted to, let's say, use, let's say 1,000 hectares to develop an industrial park. Firstly, central government has to approve this. Secondly, Shanghai government needs to work maybe with my province, Jiangsu province, said, hey, can you help me to reclaim 1,000 hectares from somewhere? So we have a balance of total agriculture land. So if we lose something, you got to develop something new. So that's the agriculture land policy. Then obviously overall planning, residential planning.
Thank you.
And I think that's something probably Africa, I'm not sure about India, Africa needs to learn. So African urban centers are spreading around without rigorous planning. That could invite huge challenges in the future. Transportation, traffics, and human health, environmental challenges.
Thank you. Thank you. Thank you very much. Thank you for that. Thank you, Professor Shenggen Fan, for that a very useful and enlightening lecture, an excellent event for the Foundation for Agrarian Studies, an excellent second annual oration. The transformation of the Chinese countryside, both in terms of production and in terms of the conditions of living of its people, is, of course, in terms of numbers, perhaps the greatest story of economic transformation of our lifetimes. This year, of course, I know that you've announced that this will be the last year of absolute poverty in the countryside in China, and that is a target that is going to be achieved in a few days. In a few months or days. Thank you very much for that, for having told us about how China, with this great experience in agricultural transformation, dealt with COVID. Thank you for your specific discussion of the term resilience and what it means on the impact of science and technology, and what are the directions that science and technology are likely to take and need to take in China, and also on the future of agriculture as an occupation, as a profession for young people in the countryside. These have been very interesting. We shall think of which it has given us not only a lot of information and knowledge, but also a great deal of food for thought. So thank you very much. And I hope that this will be the beginning of a continuing discussion between us. Thank you very much, Dr. Shenggen Fan. Thank you to the organizers.
I mean, it's a good opportunity for me too. I really hope in the future we can see each other physically. Yeah. And I also want to invite you guys to come.
Thank you to the organizers. Thank you to all those who asked to participate in the discussions and attended this second annual oration.